I'm out here to play a game with you, and the game is called Guess the Telescope. I brought three telescopes, a C925 with a focal length of 2350 millimeters, a Red Cat 51 with 250 millimeters, a 740 millimeter ED refractor, and I'm going to show you three pictures of the full moon. And your task is to match the correct picture to each telescope. Yeah, I have to continue indoors because, oh, I'm so cold. Anyway, you've seen the pictures. Now, what do you think? Which telescope produced which moon image? What I'm going to show you might surprise you. And speaking of surprises, at the end of this video, I will show you a ridiculously detailed high-resolution moon image that took me thousands of frames to create. But first, let's see if you guessed correctly. Let's start with the largest telescope, the 2350mm setup. There's no surprises here. This one produced the largest moon image. And next is the medium-sized 740mm telescope. It gives us a significantly smaller moon image. And that's also expected, because shorter focal length means smaller image. Makes sense, right? And now, let me show you the image from the smallest setup, with just 250 millimeters focal length. What? How can this tiny telescope produce a moon image that is significantly larger than the medium-sized telescope? Because I only told you half of the story. Hi, I'm Tim, and you're watching Cosmic Captures. Before I continue, I have a question to you. Was that what you expected, or did this completely throw you off? Let me know in the comments below. But now let me explain what you just saw. If you're coming from photography, you probably know that a longer focal length equals a more zoomed in image. But focal length alone doesn't tell the whole story. The size of the camera sensor also plays a crucial role. Imagine your camera sensor is a window looking out at the sky. And the bigger the window, the more of the sky you can see. And the smaller the window, the narrower the field of view. Now let's go back to the telescope in front of that sensor. You can think of it like a magnifying glass in front of our window. A stronger magnifying glass means a longer focal length, while a weaker magnifying glass, meaning a shorter focal length, lets you see more of the sky at once. So the final field of view depends on both how much the optics magnifies and how big the sensor window is. In the photography world, this is called crop factor. And in astrophotography, we can take crop factors to the extreme. Let me explain what's really happening. The largest telescope had a full-frame sensor behind it. The medium-sized telescope had an APS-C size sensor. And the small telescope had a tiny 1 over 2.8-inch sensor. And because the sensor was so small, it resulted in an extremely cropped image, making the moon appear much larger. To give you an idea of just how much sensor size can vary, here's a comparison of different sensors used in astrophotography. And as you can see, the size differences are extreme, and that has a huge impact on your final image. With so many different sensor sizes and possible telescope combinations, How do you actually know beforehand how much of the sky you can capture and how the target will look in the final frame? All right, it's time for a little bit of math. And I have to be honest, I've never been very good at this. Because seeing a page full of equations like this, yeah, it kind of scares me off. Maybe you feel the same way, but don't worry. You don't actually need to solve these to understand what's happening. Let me show you two simple and free online tools that do all the work for you. The first thing that I want to show you is called Astronomy Tools. It's a selection of different very useful tools that you can use for astronomy. What we are interested in is the field of view calculator. So if I click on that, I get to this page and there are three different modes, and the default mode is the visual mode. So if I click on imaging mode, all I need to do is select an object that I want to see in my field of view. And in my case, that is the moon. Then they have a database of different telescopes and cameras. And I tried to find the telescopes that I've used. It was a C925 Edge HD, so it's already there. The focal length is correct. And I can select the camera that I've used with that telescope. And that was a Sony Alpha 7R. That is a full frame camera. If I click on Add to View, then I get a representation of how big the moon would appear in that frame or in that field of view. And if I do that with my other telescopes, there was a TS Optics 102 APO with 714 millimeters. So that's correct already. The camera was a different one. It was an APS-C sized ASI 2600 and pick that, add to view. I do that with the smallest telescope as well. That was a Redcat 51 and the camera was an ASI 715. Add to view. And now I have these three frames and that corresponds exactly with the images that I've got in my backyard. And of course you can play around here. If you don't find your gear, you can simply enter the focal length manually. You can enter the sensor dimensions or sensor resolutions manually. And what you also then need to know is the pixel size of your sensor. Yeah, so that's the first tool, super easy to use. Yeah, maybe one thing, you can also change the object. So I can, for instance, say, okay, I want to see with those three telescopes, how big would the Orion Nebula appear in my frames. So I simply select the Orion Nebula from my list and I can see a visual representation of that. I think that's fantastic. It's a very useful tool, especially at the beginning, to get a sense for how big of a field of view you will get with your system. The second online tool that I want to show you is called Telescopius. It's a very, very powerful website. There's many things you can do here. But what we're interested in right now is the so-called telescope simulator. Because what we can do here is to select the focal length of our telescope and then also the sensor size and the sensor resolution. And what is really cool about Telescopius is that you can not only have like a fixed frame, you can also rotate your frame and work with the framing or get a sense of how will the object look in my picture. Another cool thing about Telescopius is that you can create an account and sign in. And once you do that, you can save different telescopes, different optics, and different sensors in the system. And it's very easy to pick and choose and combine them differently. Yeah, what else? I think there's so many things you can do here. It's really worth exploring this tool. I use it a lot because once I've planned my framing, I can save that and use that in a sequencer like Nina, and my telescope will align and rotate to exactly that sky position. So very powerful, very helpful. Telescopius, try it for yourself. Have you ever struggled with framing your objects in your images? Because I definitely have. And more than once, I've set up a shot only to realize later that the target was too cropped or just didn't look right in the frame. And that's exactly why a solid understanding of field of view is so valuable. It's a creative tool that can dramatically change the impact of your images. And thinking about that, that gives me an idea. What would happen if I combine my smallest sensor with my largest telescope and take a picture of the moon? I wanted to test this for myself, so just the other night I used this exact setup to take images of the moon. And since I couldn't capture the whole moon in one shot, I took a mosaic of 38 panels, each made from 1,000 individual frames. And after processing and stitching everything together, this is the result. Now, a quick word of caution. This image was only possible because the optics provided a high magnification image and the small sensor was able to turn this into a high resolution system. But there are real world limits how far we can push this. Even with the perfect setup, Mother Nature has a word to say. Atmospheric turbulence, also known as seeing conditions, will distort and blur fine details, no matter how good your optics are. And then there are the physical limitations of the system itself. The resolving power of the optics and the pixel size of the sensor determine how much detail we can actually capture. And in astrophotography, this is referred to as pixel scale. It's a different but still related topic. And perhaps that is a story for another video. Let me know in the comments below if that's a topic you would like to see. But for now, if you want to see a tiny telescope with a small sensor in practical action, check out the Deep Sky Guide for March, where I show how small telescopes can achieve impressive results on tiny galaxies. Thank you so much for watching, and clear skies to all of you.